ECG is nothing but, so it defined in three ways, ECG. Electrocardiography, electrocardiogram, electrocardiograph. Electrocardiography, electrocardiograph, and electrocardiogram. Electrocardiography is a recording. Electrocardiograph is an instrument. And electrocardiogram is the maintenance of that waves. And if you see this, what are the uses of the ECG? If you see the usage of the ECG, we can find out the heart rate and heart rhythm. We can find out whether it is normal or abnormal. And next one is abnormal electrical conduction is present or absent. And the poor blood flow into the heart muscle, that's what the cardiac muscle, it is called as ischemia. Okay. And next one, heart attacks, we can find out by this ECG. And next, coronary artery diseases, we can find out easily by this ECG. And hypertrophy of the heart chambers. These are the usage of the ECG. And next one is the ECG leads. These ECG leads are in two types. One is bipolar leads and another one is unipolar leads. Bipolar leads and the unipolar leads. First, the bipolar leads are divided into three types. That is, bipolar limb leads and bipolar chest leads. And the bipolar limb leads in two types, three types, that is limb lead 1, limb lead 2, and limb lead 3. Lead 1, lead 2, and lead 3. And if you see this, so how it acted in the sense, this, the lead 1 is connected. So whatever it is the lead, it has, it contains plus and minus voltages, electrodes, plus and minus, positive charged and the negative charged electrodes are present in this. And here, the lead 1 is connected, the negative electrode is connected to the right hand and the positive electrode is connected to the left hand. Lead 1 negative electrode is connected to the right hand and the positive is connected to the left hand. And lead 2 is the negative charged electrode is connected to the right hand and the positive pole or the positive electrode connected to the left lower limb or left leg. Okay. And the lead 3 positive charged electrode is connected to the left lower limb or left leg and the negative pole is connected to the left hand. And next one is unipolar leads. If you see these unipolar leads, these are in two types. One is unipolar limb leads and another one is unipolar chest leads. Unipolar limb leads and unipolar chest leads. If you see this unipolar limb leads, that divides into three types. That is AVR lead, AVL lead, AVF lead. Three types it is. And unipolar chest leads, if you see the positions of this, the V1 is connected to the over the fourth intercostal space. Totally six leads are present in this chest leads. So the first lead V1 it is connected at the fourth intercostal space, the left side just beside the sternum. Here it is in the fourth intercostal space. And V2 is connected over the fourth intercostal space near the left sternal margin. Is the V2. And next one, V3 is in between the V2 and V4. V3 lead is connected at the level of in between the V2 lead and the V4 lead. And V4 lead is connected at the level of fifth intercostal space on the midclavicular line. Fifth intercostal space, midclavicular line, that is, this is the midclavicular line and that is connected here, fifth intercostal space. And V6 is connected over the fifth intercostal space and the, that is in the mid-axillary line, here it is. Okay, and next one, if you see this diagram, we'll come to know where it is. V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. V1 is right side sternum on the fourth intercostal space. V2 quite opposite to the V1, that is left side sternal margin. And V3 is in between V2 and V4. And V4, fifth intercostal space. And V5, midclavicular line. And V6 is mid-axillary line. And if you see these waves and what are the causes, in the sense, there are totally 5 waves are present, that is P, Q, R, S, T waves. If you see in this, first come to the P wave. The P wave is the first wave it is. And the cause of this is atrial depolarization. Cause of this wave is, P wave is atrial depolarization and the duration is about 0.1 second. And amplitude is about 0.1 to 0.12. And QRS complex. So, including of the Q wave, R wave and S wave. Q and S are negative waves and the R wave is the positive wave. Including of this QRS, it is called as QRS complex, okay? So that is onset of the Q wave to end of the S wave is the QRS complex. And if you see the cause of this, ventricular depolarization and the repolarization is the cause for this QRS complex. And the duration is about 0.08 to 0.10 seconds. After this, the amplitude, if you see this, for the Q, it is about 0.1 to 0.2. For the R, it is about 1. And for the S, it is about 0.4. And T wave. T wave is the cause of this T wave is the ventricular repolarization. And the duration is about 0.2 seconds. Amplitude is about 0.3 seconds. And there are subdivisions are there in this, that is PR interval, RR interval, QT interval and ST segment. If you see this PR interval, that is onset of P wave to end of the T wave is called as, onset of P wave to onset of the Q wave is the PR interval. And atrial depolarization and conduction of the AV node is the cause of the PR interval. And duration is about 0.18 seconds it is. And next, QT interval, that is onset of Q wave to end of the T wave, QT interval, and the ventricular depolarization and ventricular repolarization is the cause of this QT interval. After that, the duration of this is about 0.4 to 0.42 seconds. And next, ST segment. ST segment is nothing but end of the S wave 2 and the onset of the T wave is called as ST segment. The isoelectrical action is the cause of the ST segment. And the duration is about 0.08 seconds at this. And if you see the ECG wave, that is like this. P wave is the positive wave, Q wave is the negative wave, R wave, peak it is. Okay, so that is the positive wave, and next one is including of Q or one. Q is the negative wave and R is the positive wave, another S wave is the negative wave, including of these three is called as Q or S complex. And S is also negative wave. Q wave, S wave is the negative wave, P wave, R wave, T wave are the positive waves. And here, so we can come to know easily the different waves and different segments in this diagram. And next one, if you see the cardiac cycle, how it is going on, in the sense how the aorta supplies and how the atrial systole and how the atrial diastole and how is the atrial contraction and atrial relaxation and ventricular contraction, ventricular relaxation. Atrial contraction is called as atrial systole. Atrial relaxation is called as atrial diastole. Ventricular contraction is called as ventricular systole. And ventricular relaxation is called as ventricular diastole. Arrhythmia is the abnormal sounds produced in the heart. That is because of the heart rate maintenance. During the inspiration and during the expiration, it is alters. So how, in the sense, during the inspiration, decrease in the intrathoracic pressure, and by that increase in the venous return, and at the same time increase in the lung volume. And by the increase in the venous return, the Bainbridge reflex is worked out, and then there is increase in the heart rate. And next one is, so when the stimulation of the stretch receptors by the increase in the lung volume, and then the vagal efferent impulses passed, and through that inhibition of the vasodilator area, and by that there is increase in the heart rate. That is during the inspiration. And next one is during the expiration, the increase in the intrathoracic pressure by the decrease in the venous return, and at the same time decrease in the lung volume. By that, there is a Marye's reflex is worked out, and immediately the inhibition of the vagus nerve, and next one is the heart rate is decreased. If you see the types of the arrhythmia, is it divided into two types. One is normotopic arrhythmia and another one is ectopic arrhythmia. Normotopic and ectopia. And this normotopic arrhythmia is divided into three types. That is sinus tachycardia, another one is sinus bradycardia, next one is sinus arrhythmia. Normotopic it is. And ectopic arrhythmia is divided into four types. And that one is heart block, and next one is by the extrasystole, and next one is paroxysmal tachycardia, and next one is other causes. Ectopic arrhythmia. First come to the heart block. By this heart block, there is two types of the block, that is one is sinoatrial block and another one is atrioventricular block. And this atrioventricular block, so that is because of two, incomplete heart block and complete heart block. In case of the incomplete heart block, the first degree of the heart block, and next one is second degree of the heart block, and next one is Feigenbach's phenomenon, and another one is bundle branch block. Four types. Incomplete heart block. And complete heart block is by the two types, and that is because of the AV nodal block, and another one is infranodal block. And next one is extrasystole. Systole extra, After the systole, it continues with the another systole, extrasystole. That is because of the atrial extrasystole, avinodal extrasystole, and the ventricular extrasystole. And next one is paroxysmal tachycardia is because of tachycardia in the sense increased heart rate. Bradycardia in the sense decreased heart rate. Okay, this paroxysmal tachycardia is because of the atrial paroxysma, the tachycardia, and the avinodal tachycardia, and the ventricular tachycardia. And other causes are like atrial flutter, and next one is atrial fibrillation, and next is ventricular fibrillation. These are the causes of the arrhythmia, and different causes, and by the different ways. And next one is, so how the heart maintains it impulses, and what are the generation of the this output is present, and how the heart pumped out the blood. Okay, and that is what we call as cardiac output. From the heart, how much amount of the blood is pumping out is called as cardiac output. Actually, what is cardiac output? Clearly, in the sense, okay, pumping of the blood from the heart or the each ventricle within the unit of time is called as cardiac output. This cardiac output is generally studied under the three headings. One is stroke volume, and another one is minute volume, and next one is cardiac index. What is stroke volume? Amount of the blood pumped out by the each ventricle per stroke is called as stroke volume. And minute volume, amount of the blood pumped out by the each ventricle within 1 minute is called as minute volume. And cardiac index, amount of the blood pumped out from the each ventricle per within the 1 minute and per surface area of the body, 5 meter of the surface area of body is the cardiac index. And this cardiac index is majorly depends upon the ejection fraction. Ejection fraction is nothing but end diastolic volume. At the minimum pressure, whatever is the amount of the blood is ejected out is called as ejection fraction. And cardiac reserve. So whatever it's sending out and whatever it is pumping out, there is some amount of the blood is present in the heart is called as cardiac reserve. And variations, if you see the variations in the cardiac output, that majorly because of the, there is two types of the variations. One is physiological variation and another one is pathological variation. First come to the physiological variations. If you see the physiological variations, that is by the age, depending upon the age, cardiac output increases and decreases. In children, it is decreased, and in case of the adults, it is increased. And sex, in case of the female, it is decreased, and in case of the male, it is increased. And body build, if the person is obese, the cardiac output is less. And if he is thin, cardiac output is more. And diurnal variations, morning and evenings. In the nights, it is decreased. In the morning times, it is increased. Okay, and environmental temperature. If the temperature is increased, the cardiac output is increased. And the temperature is decreased, the cardiac output is decreased. And emotional conditions. Emotional conditions, during the emotional conditions, the cardiac output is increased. And next, after meals, the cardiac output is increased because of the metabolic actions are under process. And next one is exercise. During the exercise, there is hypoxia, so that the cardiac output is increased. And in case of the high altitude, there is hypoxic conditions. Obviously, the cardiac output is increased. And posture. By the posture also shows its effect on the cardiac output. During the sleep, during the spine position, the cardiac output is decreased. And during the sitting, it is normal. And during standing, the cardiac output is increased. And in case of pregnancy, the cardiac output is increased. And during the sleep, the cardiac output is decreased. These are the conditions in the physiological variations. And next one is pathological variations. If you see the pathological variations, when it increased, in the sense, in the following conditions like the fever, anemia and hypothyroidism. And when it decreases, in the sense, so the cardiac output is decreased, and there is hypothyroidism and the atrial fibrillation. And if you see the incomplete heart block, in case of that also, so the cardiac output is decreased. And congestive cardiac failure, because of the weak contractions of the heart, that congestive cardiac failures, the cardiac output is decreased. And during the shock, so because of the circulatory shock, this cardiac output is decreased. And next, so hemorrhage, because of the hemorrhage, there is hypovolemia, the blood loss is there, so that there is decrease in the cardiac output. And what are the factors which maintains the cardiac output? In the sense, there are four factors are present. In that four factors, the first one is venous return, and next one is force of contraction and heart rate and the peripheral resistance. If the venous return is increased, the cardiac output is increased. And the venous return is decreased and the cardiac output is decreased. This is because of the muscular pump and the respiratory pump. And next one is force of contraction. If the force of contraction of the heart is the increased, and then the obviously there is increase in the cardiac output. This is also directly proportional to the force of contraction. And heart rate is also directly proportional to the cardiac output. When the heart rate is increased, cardiac output is also increased. When the heart rate is decreased, the cardiac output is also decreased. And the peripheral resistance, if blood is reserved at the particular places, that is called as peripheral resistance. If the peripheral resistance is increased, the cardiac output is decreased. And the cardiac peripheral resistance is decreased and the cardiac output is increased. So that it is inversely proportional to the cardiac output. And next, if you see the distribution of the blood flow or the cardiac output, the first organ which receives highest amount of the blood is liver. The liver receives highest amount of the blood, that is about 1.5 liters 1500 ml, and the percentage, the average rate is about 30% of total blood. And second organ is the kidney. The kidney receives about 1300 ml, 1.3 liters, and that is about 26%. And third place, skeletal muscle, that is about 900 ml, is nothing but 18%. And next, brain. Brain receives 800 ml of the blood, and that is about 16%. And next, skin, bone and gastrointestinal tract, that is about 300 ml and that is about 6%. And lowest amount received by the heart itself, it's pumping, but it receives lowest amount, that is about 200 ml, that is nothing but the 4% of total blood. And totally that is about 5 liters and the 100%. And next one is heart rate. What is heart rate? The beats per minute is called as heart rate. And this heart rate is normally, it is about 70 to 80 beats per minute. And if the heart rate is increased, that is called as tachycardia, and the heart rate is decreased, that is called as bradycardia. And regulation of the heart rate is by the two types, one is humeral and the neural. And so by the vagus nerve, it maintains neural regulation. And the so because of this, that is what the Bainbridge reflex and the Maris reflex. And there are vasomotor centers, these are the cardiac centers, so which maintains this heart rate. There is vasoconstrictor area, vasodilator area, and the sensory area. Three areas are present. And another one is motor nerve fibers, like parasympathetic nerve fibers, and next one is sympathetic nerve fibers. Next one is sensory nerve fibers from the heart. Efferent fibers, these are. And next one is factors which affect the vasomotor centers is the regulation of the vagal tone by the impulses of the from the higher centers, impulses from the respiratory centers, impulses from the baroreceptors, impulses from the chemoreceptors, impulses from the right atrium, impulses from the other efferent nerves, and the basal gyrus reflex. And if you see this diagram, we'll come to know how it is supplied. There are this vagus nucleus, which supplies to the right side, and how it supplies to the left side, and the sympathetic nerve fibers, parasympathetic nerve fibers, T1, T2, T3 and T4, which supplies to the heart. And the vagus is directly right vagus nerve and the left vagus nerve, right branch and the left branch. And when there is increase in the blood pressure, this is the Maris reflex. When there is increase in the blood pressure, at that time, stimulation of the baroreceptors. By the stimulation of the baroreceptors, impulses from the 9th and the 10th cranial nerves. By the impulsation of that 9th and 10th cranial nerves, nucleus of tractus saltarius is stimulated, and the stimulation of the vasodilator area by that increase in the vagal tone, there is a bradycardia, that is nothing but decrease in the heart rate. So when there is tachycardia, that comes to the bradycardia, decrease in the heart rate, this is called as Maris reflex. And next one is Bainbridge reflex. Bainbridge reflex is nothing but when there is a bradycardia and when it comes to the tachycardia, is called as Bainbridge reflex. So this Bainbridge reflex is because of the increased venous return. So and the by that, so immediately there is increase in the venous return. Venous return, what it will do? So there is increase in the heart rate. How in the sense? So when there is an increase in the venous return, stimulation of the stress receptors, by that there is a efferent impulses, so through the inferior cervical sympathetic nerve, and through that inhibition of the vasodilator area and decrease in the vagal tone, and then there is a tachycardia. This is what the Bainbridge reflex. And next one is, so how this vagal tone is maintained? How it increases, how it decreases? In the sense, so normal heart rate. So decrease in the vagal tone leads to, comes to normal. And sometimes when it increases, it comes to decrease. And when it decreases, it comes to increase. Okay, respiratory centers, cerebral cortex, posterior and the posterior and the lateral nucleus of the hypothalamus and the chemoreceptors, stretch receptors. So by that, there is a decrease in the vagal tone and it affects on the heart rate. And respiratory centers during the expiration and the preoptic and the anterior nuclei and the baroreceptors like Maris reflex. So by that, increase in the vagal tone and the heart rate is maintained. And after this, blood pressure. What is blood pressure? Blood pressure is nothing but the pressure present in the vessels is called as blood pressure. This pressure is in under three headings: arterial blood pressure, ventricular blood pressure and the venous blood pressure, arterial blood pressure and venous blood pressure and the capillary blood pressure. Generally, blood pressure is considered as the arterial blood pressure. And so the blood pressure is nothing but the pressure exerted by the blood on the walls of the blood vessels is called as blood pressure. This blood pressure is in under two headings majorly, and completely four it is, two major headings. One is systolic blood pressure and another one is diastolic blood pressure. If you see the systolic blood pressure, the maximum pressure exerted by the blood on the walls of the vessels is called as systolic blood pressure. This is about 110 to 130 millimeters of mercury. Averagely, it is about 120 millimeters of the mercury. And next, diastolic blood pressure is nothing but a pressure, the minimum pressure it is. Diastolic blood pressure is the minimum pressure exerted by the blood on the walls of the blood vessels is called as diastolic blood pressure. This is about 70 to 90 millimeters of the mercury, and the averagely it is about 80 millimeters of the mercury, including of this systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure, that shows as 120 by 80 millimeters of the mercury. That in the sense, systolic blood pressure by diastolic blood pressure representation it is. And next one is pulse pressure, is nothing but the diastolic blood pressure plus 1/3 of the systolic blood pressure is called as pulse pressure it is. And next one is mean arterial pressure, is nothing but the difference between the systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure. Difference between the systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure is called as mean arterial blood pressure it is. And next one is, there is some variations like physiological variations and the pathological variations. If you see the physiological variations like age, sex, body build, diurnal variations, environmental changes, temperature changes, emotional conditions and after meals, exercise, high attitude, posture, pregnancy, sleep, all this shows it effects on the blood pressure. In all the conditions it is increased, only in case of the sleep it is decreased. And so regulation of the blood pressure, how it is maintained? In the sense, the regulation of blood pressure is by the four types of the mechanisms. One is nervous mechanism, next one is renal mechanism, hormonal mechanism and the local mechanism. First come to the nervous mechanism. So nervous mechanism, by the activation of the vasomotor centers and the impulses from the periphery, from different parts. That is nervous mechanism. And next one is renal mechanism, by the regulation of the ECF volume and the renin-angiotensin system, RAS mechanism, we'll discuss in this system. And hormonal mechanism is by the hormones causing the vasoconstriction and the vasodilatation. That is also one of the important case, the cause for the regulation of the blood pressure. And local mechanism, by the local vasoconstrictions and the local vasodilatation. And next one, how the blood pressure is increased and how the blood pressure is decreased. In the sense, increased blood pressure by the increases baroreceptor firing. And when it is, it undergo for the three cases. So that is cardiac inhibitory centers, and next one is cardiac acceleratory centers, and next vasomotor centers. By all these three, it undergo for the cardiac output. It shows its effect on the cardiac output. That is, cardiac output is decreased and the vasodilatation is increased. By that, the blood pressure gets dropped. By the vasodilatation, blood pressure is dropped and the homeostasis is restored. And when the blood pressure is decreased and the immediately baroreceptor firing is decreased, by that cardiac inhibitory centers are decreased and the cardiac acceleratory centers are increases its stimulation, and the vasomotor centers increases its stimulation. By all these three, the cardiac output is increased, heart rate is increased, stroke volume is increased, and by that there is increased vasoconstriction. By that there is a blood pressure is increased and the homeostasis is restored. And how the regulation is possible, in the sense, when there is decreased in the blood pressure and the volume. So there is two types of the regulations. One is short-term regulation and another one is long-term regulation. Short-term regulation, by the sympathetic activation, by that immediately cardiac output is increased and the peripheral vasoconstriction is present, the blood pressure is increased and the homeostasis is restored. And the long-term maintenance of the blood pressure is by the kidney produces renin and the angiotensin mechanism. By that there is antidiuretic hormone release and the aldosterone mechanism and increased red cell blood formation, and by that the blood volume is increased and the homeostasis is restored. And so when there is decreased blood pressure, so in case of this, so endocrine mechanism and another one is neural mechanism. In case of the endocrine mechanism, ADH, angiotensin 2, renin, aldosterone, EPO are released and the blood volume is increased and the homeostasis is restored. And so when there is a decreased blood pressure and the volume and the neural mechanism, by the baroreceptors, chemoreceptors are stimulated and the cardiovascular centers are also stimulated, and the general sympathetic activation, releasing of the norepinephrine, and by that there is increase in the cardiac output and the homeostasis is restored. And next, so venous blood pressure, the maximum or the minimum, whatever the pressure exerted by the blood and the walls of the veins is called as venous blood pressure. And this variations is like physiological variations, pathological variations, and the physiological variations like changing in the standing and to the supine position, and the tilting of the body, and the forced expression, and next contraction of the abdominal and the limb muscles, and the effect of gravity during the prolonged traveling and the standing, and excitement are the conditions in the physiological variations. And in case of the pathological variations, that is low cardiac output, and next one is, so where the venous return is increased, in the sense venous pressure is increased, in the sense, so low cardiac output and congestive heart failures and the venous obstructions, and next one is failure of the valves and the paralysis of the muscles and the immobilizations of the parts of the body and the renal failure. And when the venous pressure is decreased, in the sense severe hemorrhage and the surgical shock. And the capillary blood pressure is nothing but the pressure exerted by the blood on the capillary vessels is called as capillary blood pressure. Okay, so this capillary blood pressure is by the is nothing but the pressure exerted by the blood on the capillary walls of the blood vessels, capillary blood vessels. Okay, so there is regional variations in the different parts. Okay, the measurement of the capillary blood pressure is not possible normally. So like the arterial blood pressure can be measured by the sphygmomanometer, and it is not possible capillary blood pressure measurement. And the capillary ancotic pressure is nothing but the plasma. So because of the plasma protease, the pressure is increased, that is called as capillary ancotic blood pressure. And so how it regulated, in the sense, so when the arteriolar constriction, by that increased resistance in the arterioles and the decreased blood flow through the arterioles and the decreased blood flow through the capillaries and the decreased pressure in the capillaries, It is quite opposite to the increased conditions like arteriolar dilatation and the decreased resistance of the arterioles and the increased blood flow through the arterioles and increased blood flow to the capillaries and then increased pressure in the capillaries. And arterial pulse. The pulse is nothing but which resembles the heartbeat or the heart rate. And it is, so there is transmission of the pulse by the velocity of the transmission of the pulse and the delay transmission of the pulse. Okay, so how we'll record in the sense by the manometer, by the Dudgeon's sphygmography and the electronic pulse transducers. And you see the pulse points and what is the variations in that. Okay, the pulse points are like temporal pulse, facial pulse, carotid pulse and the axillary pulse, bronchial pulse, the radial pulse, ulnar pulse and the femoral pulse, popliteal pulse and the dorsalis epididymis pulse and the pubis pulse and the tribal tibial pulse. These are the types of the pulse. If you see the interpretation of the arterial pulse, so then there is the examination of the radial pulse. That is, at the place of wrist, radial pulse it is, and the radial blood vessels. And how we'll examine in the sense, the rate of that pulse, and the rhythm of the pulse, and the character of the pulse, and the volume, conditions of the blood vessel walls, and the delayed pulse. And applied aspects of this pulse is pulses deficit, and the pulses alternance, and the anagogic pulse, and next threadary pulse, the weak pulse it is also called as, and pulses paradoxus, and next water hammer pulse, and abnormal pulse in the patent ductus arteriosus, and the abnormal pulse in aortic regulations. So all these are the conditions for the abnormal aspects of the pulse. And next one is coronary circulation. What is this coronary circulation? A circulation which is specialized for the heart is called as coronary circulation. This coronary circulation is like the vessels are divided into right and left coronary arteries and which divided into the epicardiac arteries. And that epicardiac artery is furtherly divided into intramural vessels. And if you see the venous drainage, so that is coronary sinus and next is anterior coronary veins and the Tibetan veins and the physiological shunt in between the arteries and the veins. And next, so the cerebral circulation is nothing but the circulation to the cerebral cortex, cerebellum and the higher centers is called as cerebral circulation. And the splanchnic circulation is circulation which is specialized for the stomach, spleen and the pancreas is called as splanchnic circulation. And the capillary circulation is nothing but the, so the capillary, whether the veins or the arteries, whatever it is, the circulation in the capillaries is called as capillary circulation. And next one is cutaneous circulation is nothing but the arteries and veins supplies to the skin is called as cutaneous circulation. And the next one is shock. What is shock? The shock is nothing but it is because of the heart failure. Due to the heart failure, there is a circulatory shock. This shock, how it is in the sense, there is acute loss, sudden loss of the blood, about 10%. Immediately there is decrease in the venous return by the decreased cardiac output. Due to the decreased cardiac output, decreased blood pressure, and it undergo for the compensatory mechanisms like baroreceptor mechanism and the renal mechanism and the ADH mechanism. And so in the baroreceptor mechanism, one is tachycardia and the vasoconstriction. And by the tachycardia, the vasoconstriction, there is increased blood pressure and it comes to the normal. And Next one is, so by all this increased blood pressure, so it undergo for the circulatory shock. And next one is by the renal mechanism, when there is secretion of the angiotensinogen that is converted into the angiotensin 1 because of the renin, and the angiotensin 1 is converted into the angiotensin 2 because of the ACE, angiotensin converting enzyme, which is secreted by the lungs. And this angiotensin 2 stimulates the aldosterone secretion, and that aldosterone affects on the vasomotor centers, and that there is a retention of the water and the sodium. And by that increased blood volume and increased cardiac output due to that increased blood pressure. And another one is ADH mechanism, also same as like the renal mechanism only. Okay, so that is the cardiac shock. And the next, so when there is a loss in this acute shock, so immediately there is serious reduction or the severe reduction in the venous system, and the blood pressure is also decreased, and by that the cardiac output is also decreased, and the severe myocardial ischemia and released into the toxins and increased capillary permeability. And in another case, the vasomotor center suppression is also one of the cause for this increased blood pressure. So, and the obstruction in the capillary blood flow, and which leads to hydrostatic pressure in the capillary and the increased capillary permeability. And if there is acute loss, if it is more than the 15%, and that is because of the decreased coronary blood flow, decreased cerebrum blood flow, and continuous sympathetic discharge, due to that, though it finally leads to death. It is more than 15%. Finally leads to death, it is. And the circulatory shock is divided into four types of the shocks, that is hypovolemic shock, and next one is vasogenic shock, and next one is cardiogenic shock, and next one is obstructive shock. Four types of the shocks. So hypovolemic shock is nothing but the circulatory shock because of the hypovolemia, decreased blood volume, and this is because of hemorrhagic shock, and another one is traumatic shock, and another one is surgical shock, next is burn shock and dehydration shock. And next one is vasogenic shock, that is because of the neurogenic shock. It may be neurogenic shock and anaphylactic shock and the septic shock. Vasogenic shock is in three types. And next one is cardiogenic shock is in under three types, that is shock due to arrhythmia, and next one is shock due to ischemia, and shock due to heart failures. And obstructive shock is under three headings, that is shock due to myocardial tumors, and shock due to cardiac tamponade, and shock due to the pulmonary vascular destruction. This is what the circulatory shock, and this is all about the cardiovascular system as per my knowledge. Thank you very much.